I should say so. Let's start season two with something interesting. And this is something that I had discussed with Chintan about what would be a good topic for this particular session. And since the flavor of the month is football and the World Cup is on, what better to start the topic on something which crosses both technology as well as sports. So my name is Jayaprasad, and let me see. And I'll give you a very brief introduction about myself. I've got roughly 19 years of experience in the industry, 9 years in hardcore R&D, and around 10 years in product engineering. And I was recently VP engineering at Revery Languages Technology in Bangalore. Of course, I'm a Berkeley Haas alumnus, and my association with Chintan was during that period. Now, interesting tidbits on my experience. The core experience that I carry is that of natural language processing, AI, and machine learning. And I've got expertise in building large-scale systems. So I was one of the primary members for building Reliance Jio's location-based services infrastructure. Moving on, let's move on to the topic. So when we say technology in sports, why does knowledge on this matter at all is something that we are going to stress on here. And we are going to look at some of the areas where tech plays a major role. Now, I think it goes without saying that tech plays a major role across the board, but I've tried to broadly classify into these five areas that we are possibly going to go through. There is one area or one sport that I'll cover in slightly more detail than some of the others. And I'll tell you why also. And finally, to sum it up, we'll discuss some of the issues, some of the barriers which face startups or companies who are dealing with this domain. So again, why this topic? I think one of the primary reasons is the most cutting edge technologies are heavily clustered in technology, in sports. They lead the way for more retail usage of the technology, and I'll stress on a few use cases later on. And other sciences, not just computer science, are in full force as far as sports are concerned. It's a very interesting domain. It's a small market, high revenue industry. It's also a very high barrier industry. It's highly regulated. You cannot enter the sport as is, as a standalone entity, and then expect entry into the sport automatically. It does not happen that way at all. Unless you have the regulators, yes, you won't be able to enter at all. Now, the areas where technology plays a key role, and these are some of the four or five areas that I've chalked out for talking about today. Some include player welfare or high performance training, for instance. Some include infrastructure advancement. Some include game time assists. Some include pre-game strategy. There's media infrastructure and media infrastructure add-ons. Now, each of this is possibly a candidate for a complete session on itself. So I'll try my best to sort of give you a flavor of where technology is playing a role in each of those areas right now. To start off with, we'll cover high performance training and player welfare. Now, medical science is not going to be a part of this particular discussion right now, but it warrants its own discussion, and you would probably have a discussion on how do you utilize medical technology or medical science for a much more speedier injury healing process, for a high frequency physiotherapy, for things like low oxygen training and so on. I mean, how do you get the player to be in a much better state, or how do you get the athlete to be at his very peak using medical science and using the latest advances in physiotherapy? And it's well recognized that by even players that if they go through a very rigorous training process. They are known to improve almost 25% from whatever raw skills that they had. So Zahir Khan has a statement saying that just by training, he went from 140 kilometers per hour to up to 150 kilometers per hour. That's just through sheer training and sheer physiotherapy related assistance that he was provided as a part of the Indian cricket setup. Now, the part that I would possibly be just dwelling a bit is technologies for assessment and recalibration of some things that we can understand much more than the medical side of things. So these technologies that are in use, especially in athletics or in sports like cricket, football, what have you, are the industrial strength versions found in the retail market usually. So, and they deal with things like biomechanics and stuff like that. Now, one particular technology that I want to deal with or talk about is GPS tracking devices. It's very well understood by us. It is part of our daily lives. Any decent smartphone utilizes a GPS tracking device. But what's the difference as far as sports are concerned? So with sports, one of the things, I'm not sure whether everybody is able to see my screen. So one of the things that is...
Yeah, we are able to see your screen.
Yeah. So if you look at the images on your right, you'll see a lot of players wearing something very interesting. It's a black shaped contraption that all the players on the top, I mean, dressed in blue, are wearing. And even some of the players who are dressed in red are wearing here. Now, this is a very interesting device which has been created by a company called StatSports. And it collects industrial strength GPS. It has industrial quality accelerometer. It has industrial quality high impact accelerometer. It has industrial strength gyro, magnetometer. And it can connect to auxiliary devices like a heart rate monitor, etc. Now, this is obviously worn inside the vest. So what ends up happening is once a player goes out on the field, this is worn inside, and it's regulated by FIFA. FIFA has allowed the usage of this particular contraption on the field. Now, what does this do? It allows for two things. You get live data as far as the player position is concerned, the player movement is concerned, and you're able to understand where is the energy being spent as far as the overall player is concerned in that particular gameplay. So to understand the overall analytics portion of it, the player data needs to be connected to the cloud, and this particular contraption allows you to do that. The beauty of this contraption is it's got 9 hours battery in and by itself, and can allow you to, and comes with the cloud framework that I talked about. It's got interesting things like a Bluetooth LE connection, which will allow you to connect it to a heart rate monitor and stuff like that. So this is actively used by players in training, definitely. But in more and more games nowadays, you would probably see players who are wearing this, especially. I'm not sure whether in the World Cup they're wearing it right now. But if you look at any of the club games, they're definitely wearing it. And it allows the home team to get an understanding of how their players are performing. You won't get data from the visiting team, but at least you get understanding of how your players themselves are performing. Moving on to a slightly more complex case of biomechanics. Now, the GPS tracking device that we mentioned earlier is a very simplified use case compared to what we are looking at right now. Now, if for true lovers of cricket, you'll probably remember Murali Dharan's action controversy, right? And there was a controversy where Murali Dharan was not banned really, but allowed to go through like an action correction. And similarly for Harbhajan Singh and so on. And what happens over there is not just make those players go through a course, but also look at their action in a much more detailed fashion. And one of the core technology pieces over there is the motion capture technology. Now, motion capture is very common in movies right now. Avengers Infinity War, for instance, the Thanos character is a completely motion capture character. The Hulk character is a completely motion capture character. But in sports, it allows you to track how you are performing or how what is the way in which you are hitting the ball. So here, for instance, this is Glenn Maxwell wearing a motion capture suit. What? And there are cameras all around.
Yes,
so here's Glenn Maxwell, who's going through a motion capture setup. He's got a motion capture suit, and there is an array of cameras all around him to detect exactly how he's hitting any given shot. Now, this belongs to a field called biomechanics, where you study how the player behaves or the player acts in a certain situation, or what is the overall movement as far as a player is concerned in this particular case of hitting a ball, for instance. It's heavily used in golf because in golf, if you don't have the right shot, you will develop a back pain eventually. So people go through like a motion capture setup and understand what is the exact nature in which they're hitting a shot on the golf course and whether it needs to be corrected so that they have longevity in their own careers. So now obviously this is very cutting edge technology. It's not run of the mill technology that you can construct at your home, but there are ways you can probably do it. And one of the ways that I've recommended is if you want to create a motion capture device yourself, you need to have something like a Kinect version 2 and a software called Blender for creating a home version of a motion capture device. So this is the Kinect version 2 is very interesting because it has support for skeletal tracking, infrared cam, because it has a regular cam, and it has a microphone array. So that's possibly a DIY tip for people who are interested in creating something on a smaller scale, but at home. Moving on. Now, the second area that I want to talk about is infrastructure enhancement as a piece, as an area where technology plays a key role in. And I'll pick a topic that you would probably not expect. When is grass not grass? So the pitch or the football ground that you look at right now on TV while watching the World Cup matches, most of them have something unique there. It's largely natural. The reason to keep it largely natural as opposed to keeping it artificial turf is because natural grass pitch is great for the legs of athletes. If you go to an artificial turf, the injuries are immediate, almost immediate. So the general recommendation across the board is use natural grass as much as possible. But there are huge challenges, meaning if you want to create a football pitch like that, you have to understand that grass is a super sensitive plant. Natural grass regrowth is not straightforward. It comes off easily. And how do you fix a barren patch of grass? I mean, do you just bring a patch of grass along with you and put it over there? So it's not foolproof if you try to do it that way, right? So there has been an interesting invention which is called reinforced natural grass. This hybrid grass, that is natural grass mixed with artificial yarn. And so you first, if you look at the figure on your left and you see those artificial yarn just probing downwards, what happens is once you put the grass seeds along with it, the grass roots get entwined with those artificial yarns. And it's easier to manage the entire superstructure. So for instance, if you want to create a new pitch altogether, you can just take this entire thing as a mat and just place it on the entire field. So there are two technologies there at your disposal, which is one is which is called as Deso Grassmaster, where you actually weave these artificial grass strands, and then you sort of sow the grass seeds over it, or use something called as a fiber sand, where you just lay out the entire grass like a mat. Now the figure on your left is even more interesting because it covers more than what is involved at a pitch level. So at the lowest level, you have the drainage pipe, and then you have a gravel drainage layer. And then most interestingly, you on top of it, there is, if you look at those orange circles, that's your undersoil heating system. So that the water does not remain for too long on top of the grass also. So that allows the entire grass to look very smooth as it looks right now. So if you go back and look at your older World Cup videos, you'll see very bad pitches, very bad football pitches. And that has all been circumvented by this technology right now. Let's take a look at another picture, which is very interesting. So this is a picture of two stadiums, one in the dusk on the left-hand side and one in the night on the right-hand side. And you'll see a very interesting contraption here spread across the pitch. So the stadium is being lit, but not at a stadium level, but only at the pitch level. And one of the reasons it's being lit is because of the grass requiring good sunlight over an extended period of time to retain its quality. Now, this is something that you might not know of, but this happens behind the scenes. When people go home, they just take care of the grass so that it remains healthy for the next match. And it's called stadium grass growth lighting. And it's a very interesting piece of technology which was discovered by a rose farmer living in Netherlands. So over a period of time, let me just change the slide. So this horticulturist, his name was Nico van Furen. He was a rose farmer, and his primary interest was how do we keep the grass healthy or in the pitch for an elongated period of time. So he discovered that you need perfect conditions for the grass, and you need perfect sunlight or lighting conditions for the grass as well. So he came up with this overall infrastructure, which has been used for the last 10 years at least right now. And Arsenal was one of the few stadiums which adopted it very early in England. There were a lot of teams which adopted it even earlier in Netherlands. So in terms of horticulture coming to technology or coming to sports, this is a very interesting and useful use case. And then there is an added factor, meaning for the grass to grow well, you need good airflow across the entire stadium. And that is a very retrospective thinking for most stadiums, because you don't build a stadium that way. You build the seats first, you then lay out the pitch, and then that's it. But nobody cares about the airflow inside the stadium or on the pitch. That was never a factor. It was just an airflow outside the system. How does the stadium react to heavy breezes or heavy storms and stuff like that? But what happened very recently is, I'm going to take the case of this particular stadium. This is Arsenal's Emirates Stadium. And this was one of the first football stadiums created with the football pitch in mind. So if you look at, there is sufficient amount of airflow which flows into the stadium and over the pitch in a much more distributed, well-distributed fashion. And they use heavy computational fluid dynamics just to understand how the airflow is going to take place such that the pitch is the best pitch in England. So Arsenal is one of the geekier clubs which ended up doing all these cutting edge things for their for the quality of the pitch, so that their pitch happens to be the smoothest pitch of all. And their groundsman was consistently ranked as the number one groundsman in England for a long period of time. Now, this gives you an idea of infrastructure enhancements which are possible in technology. I'm not talking about infrastructure, the core infrastructure per se, but infrastructure assistance. Now, besides that, a crucial area where technology plays a very good role is game time assist. And I think the figure is very clear when I say, what does game time assistive technology look like? What you're looking at is a DRS, right? With Hawkeye playing a crucial role. And that's what game time assistive technology has evolved to. I mean, it's fairly cutting edge right now. So if you look at football, you have VAR right now, which is assisting the referees on a continuing basis. And there is goal line technology using Hawkeye, right? If you look at cricket, you have the umpire decision review system, which is fairly sophisticated. It takes into account several things like a snicometer, which is essentially two or three array microphones kept around the stump trying to detect a sound wave. You have the light illumination meter, which the umpire on the ground carries. You have infrared cams for hot spots on the bat. Right, so when you look at replays, you'll see the snicometer, and sometimes you'll see like a negative image on the screen trying to detect where the ball has hit the bat. Right, so that's an infrared cam there. And then you have a Doppler for detecting the ball speed. So whenever it says Zahir Khan or Ashish Nehra is bowled at whatever 142 kilometers per hour, that's your Doppler technology playing the role of understanding what is the ball speed. And of course, there is the most complex technology of all, which is the Hawkeye. I'll come to Hawkeye in a bit. There are additional things which are not really technology per se, but more of science being applied to assist the game in general. So you have modern mathematical models like Duckworth-Lewis-Stern methods. So the earlier method was called Duckworth-Lewis. The recent model is called Duckworth-Lewis-Stern. And this allows you to predict, given a curtailed match, what should be a fair score for a team to chase. Right? And then there are things like drag reduction zones in F1, etc. It's useful for us to spend some time over this piece of technology. So it's called Hawkeye, and it was created by a scientist called Paul Hawkins in England. And it was purchased by the Wisden Group and then sold to Sony in 2010. Now it's a part of, it's essentially an infrastructural setup as we'll see soon. And it's great for cricket and football. It's facing some rough weather as far as tennis is concerned, because tennis deals with line hits and line misses, meaning if a ball misses the line, you need to be very accurate about what is the distance by which it has missed the line. The problem is Hawkeye has an error of 3.6 millimeters, whereas all the recent misses in tennis have been misses of 1 millimeter, 2 millimeters. So there is right now a controversy brewing in tennis whether a better technology is needed or Hawkeye needs to be discarded altogether. But I'm in favor of technology provided to provide a good result generally. So I would err in the favor of using Hawkeye most of the times. Now, Hawkeye is a very key infrastructural piece right now in for quite a few sports. So you, tennis, football, and cricket are a few of the sports that we are well aware of, right? And for football, it's playing a crucial role in figuring out whether the ball has crossed the line. That is, it's doing goal line technology. Right? So the way Hawkeye operates is, if you look at a goalpost, there are at least 6 cameras which are pointing at that goalpost. Now, there is a football velocity sensor which is also used. So these 6 cameras plus the velocity indicator allow Hawkeye technology to triangulate the ball and predict its trajectory. Now, this is a well-patented technology by Paul Hawkins, and it has allowed immediate decision-making also. So as soon as the ball crosses the line, there is the Hawkeye systems conveys to the backend that a goal has been, a goal is in process, and the backend system then conveys it to the referee's watch immediately that it's a goal. But yeah, one of the crucial factors over there is your error is 3.6 millimeter, right? So which it actually applies well for football as compared to tennis, because tennis is slightly more sensitive there. Now, let me give you a quiz, right? And if, feel free to unmute your microphones. So, which sport was responsible for the creation of carbon fiber?
Tennis?
No.
Is it Formula One?
Oh, yes. It's Formula One. And this is one sport that is bathed in high technology. I mean, it just reeks of high technology all the time. It's the pinnacle of technology in sport. And I'll give you why, the exact reasons why. So first of all, if you look at the car itself, it's a sensor storm on wheels. Every F1 car has anywhere between 100 and 150 sensors on board. Imagine these number of sensors. It's no other instrument that you would have discussed about, known about, would have that many sensors on board. And these are some of the sensors that can be described on a piece of paper. And I'll leave it as a part of the slides for anybody who wants to understand what are those sensors which are at play. Now, the interesting thing is these sensors are essential as part of the overall telemetry of F1 to understand exactly how the car is behaving. Now, an F1 deals with heavy duty infrastructure across the board. It has data centers on wheels. And I'm not talking about the F1 car only. It has its own weather system. Okay. Tell me one sport which comes along with its own weather system. It has massive data collection and aggregation setup, and I'll walk you through one of the information flow of architectures that I have. And it requires a heavy game time analytics setup. So you have to understand that a millisecond is very sensitive as far as Formula One is concerned. And you need to know details, not just details about your car, but also position of every other car on the field at that point of time. So if you make a strategic decision or a tactical decision at this point of time, it is with respect to every other car on the field, it is with respect to the climate at different points of the racetrack, and it is with respect to your fuel conditions, your other car conditions like your tire degradation, your racetrack degradation, whether there is somebody who has gone in for a pit stop and so on and so forth. So it depends on factors which are not just your own, but every other factor of every other car combined. And besides this, you would want minute control on all aspects of the car. So it is a common joke in Formula One that it is very easy for the race engineers sitting at the paddock to control the car. And they're not far from the truth, because that's the level of telemetry and control that they can exert also. But good sense has prevailed and the driver controls most of the control aspects on the car. So besides this, it has, it utilizes heavy material design. So a lot of material science which goes into account, and carbon fiber is one of the things which emerged out of the material science infrastructure in England. Heavy structural design, heavy usage of computational fluid dynamics. And I'll tell you why carbon fiber also came to the picture, right? So they required something which was not just sturdy, but extremely light. And the material that they were toying around with most of the time was carbon. So they ended up creating strands of carbon and then baking it to create a superstructure which had not just the strength of steel, but also did not carry the load that steel would bring along. It did not have that amount of weight. Of course, all this comes at a cost. So every F1 car would probably cost roughly around £6 million. And that's because of not just all those customized pieces going in, but also the software pieces which go in as a part of the overall car. So this is a rough distribution of what the cost of every portion of the car looks like. Let me also discuss an interesting infrastructure piece as far as the overall F1 car is concerned, or the F1 setup is concerned. So you have to understand the F1 setup, or an average track length is anywhere between 4 kilometers to 5 kilometers. So it easily means that the climate on one side of the track may not be related to climate on any other side of the track. So if you're looking at this particular track, if you look at the top side where the top segment 6, 7, 8, that climate may not be related to the bottom side of the track, which is segment 14, 15, 16. So that used to be a very strategic piece owned by each of the teams, meaning they had their own weather provider. And that used to be a very tactical piece. If you were, let's say, Ferrari or McLaren, and you had the best weather data provider, you would always have a tactical edge over any of the other teams. So the reason why weather or climate data is important is because your tire degradation data and your tire grip data is heavily dependent on this information. So there are at least 6 to 7 types of tire compounds which are utilized by Pirelli. If you end up utilizing the wrong mix for the current set of climate conditions, then you'll easily end up losing your space or losing your position in the next lap or so. So your strategy is heavily affected. So what happened was, as late as or as early as 2008, 2010, the F1 committee decided that it was best that everybody had the same weather data provider. So so right now they've standardized to Meteo France. Ubimet was the supplier earlier. And the way economics works as far as a weather data supplier is concerned is, I think Meteo France roughly charges them 500,000 euros per year per team. Now, but you have to understand this, that this is a very sensitive data information as far as every F1 team is concerned. And they get grumpy very quickly if things are unnies, bees and so on. So they want very high degree of accuracy. I mean, we are talking about weather prediction here at like a sub 10 kilometer range. So very high amount of precision is required. Very high amount of predictability is also required. And due to the nature of the precision, the general dissatisfaction is always very high. Now, the second thing which these teams do very well is training assist. Meaning, so although they've designed the car to be very, very quick and all the pieces are custom designed to take aerodynamics fully into account, they need to test whether it's working out there at all. So the image on your screen is very interesting. So what they've done is they've kept a mesh. They end up putting a mesh on the side of the car that where they want to test whether their computational fluid models are performing well at all. So if you look at the image behind this blurb, it's a Mercedes with a mesh being kept just behind the driver. And on the right is a Red Bull car with a mesh being kept just on top of the wheel to test how the eddies are circulating just around the wheel. So that's an interesting piece of even assessment, because for a long period of time, people could not figure out whether their computational fluid dynamic models are actually performing the same way out there on the racetrack at all. So they ended up creating this assessment technology to understand what is the current state of the aerodynamics flow for a given piece of the car or a given portion of the car. And then you have the steering wheel, right? Meaning on your top, on the top is a regular BMW steering wheel. And on the bottom is what can be easily called as a nightmare for us regular guys. So this is how the right side is your dashboard, right? I mean, these are the possible set of icons or lights that you would see on your dashboard. As your ABS system, there is your airbag system, there is your handbrake system, there's your check engine light and so on. On the left-hand side is a sober F1's steering wheel. Now this controls the entire car. Without the steering wheel, you cannot operate an F1 car at all. It controls everything. If there is a tactical command which comes from the paddock or from the engineer's paddock, from your team principal, you would press a series of buttons on this car to implement that part. In F1, you know the concept of a pit stop, right? A pit stop speed is very special. You cannot go past the speed which has been regulated as a part of the overall pit stop lane. So even to enter the pit stop lane, what the drivers end up doing is not just control the speed using their own skills, but they press a button on this, which just takes care of the overall pit stop speed, and there is no room for error after that. Which means that even the FIA, that is the governing body, they have sensors as well. So the sensors which come from the car to the engineers and the sensors which go from the car to the FIA are the same set of sensors. But it means that if you miss a beat on an F1 track, the FIA is going to regulate you or penalize you almost immediately. I'm not going to discuss the steering wheel, but it's a very fascinating piece of technology here. It does gear changes, speed regulations, changes in overall aspects of the car or overall positioning of some of the aspects of the car. It does DRS and stuff like that. It does KERS. And I think we don't have enough time to go through it. But it's a very fascinating piece of technology which gives you an idea about how minute the amount of control these drivers wield over their individual cars. We'll go to a section which is possibly more interesting for us, right? Meaning the images on top are very interesting also, but I'm not going to go through those. So on the left side is the number of tire compounds which are usually used or which are used as a part of the 2018 season by the various Formula One cars. And on your right are the various tracks they will be going through this year. What we are going to discuss is very interesting to me personally. It's the F1 information architecture. So when we say that it's a data stream or it's a data center on wheels, I'm not joking. It's so you have a sensor storm emerging from the car itself. Huge amount of telemetry data, which is coming at a millisecond, microsecond layer level, not microsecond, but more of a millisecond level from the F1 car. And that data needs to flow to the FIA. It needs to flow to the team engineers. It needs to flow to the track side, the principal who's going to select a strategy for you. And it needs to go to your factory back home. So most of the teams have a factory in England, just around Milton Keynes, like a 5 to 10 kilometer radius around that place. So it needs to go there. It needs to go to your engineers who are going to assess what is the kind of analytical strategy that we need to give to the principal for a real-time choice, and so on. So look at the number of data replications which are happening across the board. So it means that this data is not just available to you, trackside. It's available to people back home. Who will give you what are the possible strategies at play right now. So it also goes to FIA, which is the governing body. So that's the way they can track whether you are entering the pit lane at the regulated speed and leaving it at a regulated speed or not. They can regulate what is the speed at which you should be traveling behind the virtual safety car and so on. So the interesting thing is, so I think Tata also does provide all this infrastructure for a team. So it means that the analytics team can be easily operating out of Mumbai or Bangalore. And they'll have the same data coming to their servers to make either an ad hoc analysis or a real-time analysis or to give a report. And you have to understand that all this three information or three brackets of information need to be fed back to the main person in the paddock, who is the principal. Now that person will be taking decisions live based on whatever analytics information that is coming from either Bangalore, Mumbai or wherever the analytics team is sitting. So it's spread out that way. So it used to be the case that previously most of the decision was taken at trackside itself. But right now they have the luxury to sort of stream this data across to two or three portions where they're looking at various aspects of the car or the strategy. So for instance, your engineering team is looking at how the car is performing right now. Whereas your analytics team is looking at what the car or the driver needs to do over a period of 2 to 3 laps. And they give about a report about what are the overall strategic pieces which are up for grabs by the principal over the next 1 minute or 2 minutes, for instance. Right? So that's an interesting piece, and this is all happening live. So imagine the amount of data which is flowing across at any given point of time during the race. Now what happens is they tend to store this data even after the race so that they can go through exactly what has happened and diagnose it. So it's almost like a super version of your black box, which your plane carries, for instance. But here the black box is being utilized almost after every match, every race, or it's used during the race as well to understand what is the exact condition of the car. So the other thing that it allows you to do is it's telemetry data, which is flowing from the left, which is from the cars to these set of data centers here. But there is also a control information architecture, which flows from the right to left, which flows from the track side to the car, meaning they can utilize that control infrastructure if they want to. That is usually not allowed as a part of the regulation, but that's what they mean when they say that you can possibly drive the car by a team of engineers sitting in the factory also. Now, to sum up the entire landscape, in terms of sports, technology is a very highly regulated piece. It depends heavily on the regulator for tech adoption. So if you look at governing bodies like FIA, these are very smart governing bodies. They need to utilize technology to guide the teams, how the car should be made for the next year and so on. But for for sports which have a lesser play of technology, like football, for instance, it's a very uphill road. Just to get FIFA to allow for a goal line technology took around 10 to 15 years. It was there already, right? In different sports. And once you enter that market, I think it's a high revenue market immediately. But that's where the roadblock comes in, right? If you're a small company and you want to sell a product in the market, you can't just sell a product for utilizing it in a live game or in a live race. You have to go through like a huge body like FIA or FIFA or UEFA or ICC or BCCI, for instance, right? So some countries, for instance, do this better compared to others. If you look at the Hawkeye technology itself, it just came through because England was smart enough to adopt it at a much earlier level. They looked at the piece of technology which was developed by Paul Hawkins and were very, very forthright to adopt it immediately. And they allow even scientific advances or like the Duckworth-Lewis, for instance, to allow for suggestions as a part of the overall improvement of sports. So England, South Africa, USA, Germany, and Japan have a history of utilizing technology much earlier. And at least their governing bodies have a history of utilizing this much earlier than others. The flip side of all this is what happens is media companies have understood that they have a larger role to play in terms of infrastructure, not just media coverage. So Sony, for instance, has gone about acquiring Hawkeye, which is right now an infrastructure level piece of technology as far as cricket is concerned, or football or tennis. So imagine the number of sporting avenues where it can play a huge role almost immediately. So the market for it is almost immediate right now. It also allows them to have a say about what is the kind of fee structure that they'll possibly utilize as a part of the overall subscription to that technology is concerned. So since this is a complex piece of equipment, technologies like the spider cam for an overhead coverage of the match, or even complex pieces of technology like Hawkeye, they're not sold, they're leased, or At least there is a subscription model for either the governing body or the company. I'll open this session for questions. Thank you all for listening to this session intently.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jay. This was really very informative.
Thank you. It was a nice session. Thanks for the information.
So this is Jay has been one of the early members of TMI, and he has always been helping us conduct multiple activities, and webinar is one of them. Last year, Jay started this webinar. This year, he is the first one. So this is technology in sports from an expert in AI and machine learning. So thanks, Jay, for delivering this webinar for all of us. And I mean, it was indeed insightful to learn that a lot of technology. Yes, we have heard about Hawkeye, but we saw it from a Hawkeye only. So you gave us the background and more information for Hawkeye and other technologies, especially F1. And you were it was good to have various examples also included in this presentation. Mm-hmm. So I'll also request everyone to share that feedback. Ojas Bhai, Suresh, Sarthak, Mandar, if you can just share your views.
Mukunda. Absolutely. And we can also ask questions if we have any, right?
Oh, yes. Please go ahead.
Wonderful.
Yeah, this session has been short because I think you can't cover all the sports in one session.
Right.
So I have spent a lot of energy looking at football and F1 over a period of time, especially from behind the scenes kind of an activity, because it's not possible to cover it instantly. If you want to go about reading it over a period of a week or two, that's not possible.
Absolutely.
But if you are following the sport intently, and not just from a sporting level, but from a technology level about what are the emerging trends, it helps you a bit to understand what's going on behind the scenes.
Definitely. So I have a question. So I posted a question in the chat about just the steering wheel and the interfaces that go into that.
Mm-hmm.
I can read that out, but basically it's about what is the training time associated with learning to use a system like that? And is this something that keeps changing year on year?
Okay. So what happens is they start with the template steering wheel per team. So it's not necessary that if you go from, let's say, Lewis Hamilton, right? He went from McLaren to Mercedes. The steering wheel that he had from McLaren is very different from the steering wheel that he has from Mercedes. The steering wheel that he has for Mercedes for year 2016 is different from the year 2017, different from the year 2018. So it's a acquired skill, especially going from one steering wheel to another. But if you're part of the same team, you can refine it to a level which is convenient to you. Let's take Sebastian Vettel's steering wheel versus Kimi Raikkonen's wheel. So they're both Ferrari, right? You would ideally expect their steering wheels to be largely similar, but they are not. So they start off with a common base about how the steering wheel should look like. And then the driver starts taking over in terms of the overall design of the steering wheel. What are the advanced contraptions that need to be a part of the steering wheel to control the car even better?
That's so interesting. And I'm assuming that there's also a lot of simulation that happens behind the scenes where can practice driving in all these different cars.
And I didn't cover simulations, but it should probably called as the infrastructure extension itself. because the way they are creating simulation goes far beyond whatever computer games that you might have. So they are replicating the track to a level which is incredible, meaning they'll probably even simulate the bumps along the track if necessary. So every driver, and Lewis Hamilton is one of the best simulation drivers, because he goes through the amount of training Lewis Hamilton goes through before any match is super. He goes through a lot of simulation driving before the match, before the track, before the race rather, where he understands the overall track, and that would be anywhere between like 100 to 300 laps. So during a race is what, 60 laps, 70 laps is, or anywhere between 50 to 70 laps is what you would expect. So these guys are racing like 100 to 300 laps before a race starts. And imagine they go through practice one, practice two, and the actual race. So that's the level of comfort that they want to get to before even starting the race.
I see. And actually mentioning the virtual aspect of it actually ties into my next question as well, which is that as I guess technology evolves and the internet and things like that, you start seeing the development of new sports, specifically esports. And there are computer games that become very popular that attract like this exact same type of training. So I'm not sure how familiar you are with this, but do you feel like because, so first of all, are you familiar with any of these new sports?
Esports?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. I'll tell you a case where it has gone from the world of esports back into the real world as well. So what happened, let's say around 8 years back or 10 years back, so when you talked about simulation, Sony had an idea, why not utilize these simulations and train newbies, okay, as a part of the simulation, and then take them on track. And they were incredibly successful at it. So there is a case that it's not just esports which will start taking over, but also there is a possible migration path from esports for cases like F1 or track sports to go into the real world.
Understood. That's all from me. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thanks. I didn't catch your name. I'm sorry.
This is Arthur.
Great question, Arthur. Anyone else? So this topic also rose from a personal curiosity about what would it take for somebody to create a company in the world of sports. And some of the homework that I did was very interesting. I found out that you want to create something like Hawkeye. Your avenues are very limited. I mean, you can create the technology, but you know that there is only one entity that you would probably need to go through at the end of the day for it to be accepted across the sport. So right now it's fairly monopolistic in terms of technology usage. So I'm hoping at some point of time, sports or the governing bodies at least allow it to be democratized.
Would it be possible to pitch in with something related to this point?
I'm sorry.
Hi, this is Sarthak again. Would it be possible to pitch in with something related to this point about this market structure? Okay. Yeah, sure. So the interesting thing about new types of sports and I guess new forms of entertainment that are coming up is if they tend to be based in a largely virtual world. So instead of having the BCCI or the ICC to go through in case of cricket, you would have the gaming company themselves. So I'll give the example of two popular games right now, PUBG and Fortnite. So the game, so in this case, it's the exact same market structure. The companies that you have to sell to are EA and Valve. So, and what's exciting about this is because this is largely a software-driven sport, and because they are themselves are fighting for market share in terms of the attention span. This is another area which could be more open to technology as a whole, with whatever we've discussed. So that's all.
Sure. There is a separate presentation I can do on gaming by itself, but I don't know. It's very easy for me to do that presentation.
We look forward to that. Yeah, I mean,
sure, Chintan, you would look forward to that.
So, I mean, today we had 23 participants. So many people logged in and logged off at different point of time. So totally we had 23 participants.
Cool.
And I hope everyone available here today, they enjoyed the presentation. It was quite informative. And I would request Suresh to do the vote of thanks. Suresh?
I most after 1 year I joined, this, you know, Sindhan used to encourage me to join that. But today, you know, first time, you know, I fully, was with that session. So it was quite interesting, you know, how much effort you put to prepare, we don't know. But really we enjoyed and we understand that lot of technology is involved. And, you know, thank you so much because, you know, the word is, you know, I can't explain that, you know. I literally understand that, you know, the Formula One and all, you know, lot of things we understood. That's what, you know, the thanks, Jay, for that. Cool. Wonderful, informative. And, you know, it's like, you know, even I didn't, almost 1 hour, I didn't gone out. Almost every 5 minutes, I'm in the office today because... Especially a game, at home I may not be able to, distraction will be there. So, for especially this session, I came here. At least 1 hour I want to spend. Thank you so much. That's the level of, you know, interest.
Thanks, Suresh. That's so nice of you.
Great. We also have Jamshid, our permanent vote of thanks person. Welcome, Jamshid. Maybe please do the honors.
Yeah, thank you, Chintan. So Jai, it is always a pleasure to listen to your sessions. They are very informative, and trust me, pretty much I can say 90% of the stuff I personally did not know, you know, which you touched upon. Especially while, you know, Formula One has always been very much advertised in terms of being at the pinnacle of technology. But when it came to the other aspects of football and cricket and the Kinect to motion capabilities and motion tracking capabilities and Hawkeye, it brings in a lot of different perspective. What was very interesting was also that, you know, you had brought in the aspect of how the grass laying technology, so much of technology goes into that, which, you know, something we tend to kind of just overlook, which otherwise we would say that only the groundsman or the Mali would be, you know, managing the grass and building the pitch. But the amount of precision, technology, research that goes into it, it was simply an eye-opener, and we really liked it that, you know, you brought it down to a very simple, lucid manner of understanding which anyone can understand. And really thank you for, you know, bringing these wide and varied perspectives of what today, you know, we actually don't see behind the scene kind of technology taking place in as simple as things what one would consider in the game of football or cricket. So thank you once again, Jay, for this wonderful and insightful session.
Thanks, Jamshid.
Thanks. Mukundan, do you have something to update? I saw your hand.
Sorry, this was Murli here.
Oh yeah, Murli, tell me.
Yeah, in fact, Chintan and Jamshed, you know, since we have the official association with Formula One, right? And there is a Formula One innovation contest, which is just commenced, right? So how about you know, inviting some of the people in this forum who are absolute, you know, technology or sports aficionados to participate in that, because you know it's a lump sum, $50,000 is what the prize money is. And then, you know, it is completely ingrained, the whole contest is ingrained in technology, right? So Chintan and Jamshed, you know, won't it be really a great moment for us if one or two of the members of, let's say, TMI actually grab the prize this year?
What's the competition?
The Formula One Innovation Prize is there, right? So every year they come together to make Formula One more in exciting with by bringing, you know, the cutting edge technologies to the user experience, to the driver experience, to the sports itself. So it has just launched a couple of days back. So I was just thinking while Jay was actually walking us past the Formula One, why not we actually share the details with them? Because it's not applicable for the Tata employees, right? So it's only those who are non-Tata employees are eligible for this contest.
So I think, Murli, that's a very valid and a good suggestion that you made. And possibly, Chintan, by what we can do is on our WhatsApp group, we could kind of share the link to the innovation contest that is there. This is an annual event that is, you know, co-sponsored by Tata Communications and Formula One together to kind of boost and drive innovation in terms of what new kind of innovations can be brought into the field of Formula One. So, given that there are a lot of sports fans that we now know that are there on our forum, I think this would be the perfect opportunity for, you know, the team to kind of showcase their creative side in terms of how we could further innovate when it comes to Formula One.
You're right. It can help people bring together their technology.
Sure, definitely. Valid point, Murli. Let me explore it tomorrow. I mean, day after tomorrow when I resume office, and let's hope that we are able to share it further with this forum. Definitely. So, Murli, I hope you like this, the first webinar. And what's your feedback? What are your comments?
And I've been following Formula One for the last at least 20 years or so, ever since Mika Hakkinen and Schumacher rivalry started way back in 1998-99. So, you know, I was so joyous to understand a lot of things which go behind, right, in constructing a car. Of course, you know, I can't agree more than the leading car on the wheel, right? So one term which I really loved was the sensor storm. Right, so I don't think so. I've ever heard this specific term ever, and no doubt the Formula One car is nothing but a sensor storm. In fact, you know, there are 185 sensors. There were 185 sensors way back in 2015. I overheard in a commentary, but I'm not sure how much do they have today, because with the advancement of the user experience, right? Formula One is all about.
They reduced it because there was a massive complaint that it's the principal and the engineers who are trying to take over the car rather than the driver doing it.
Yeah, that is one. In fact, you know, the DRS rules also have come into place in a very different shape and form today, right? Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, you're right. You know, the way the car looks today compared to, you know, what in 2002-2003, that, you know, 4 years of consecutive you know, championship that Michael Schumacher won, the car has gone through, you know, immense change in terms of the aerodynamism, and of course, you know, a lot of technology has come into play, but ultimately, you know, what has happened is that today it's between the car, the driver, and the spectators, right? So the spectatorship is actually dipping for Formula One, and therefore they have to make it really more interesting. And therefore, you know, we as an organization, you know, as Tatacom, you know, we are the official connectivity provider. You spoke about, you know, the racetrack to the factory, right?
Yeah.
The communication that has to go real time as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that is something which actually Tatacom facilitates for Mercedes,
It does more than Tata does more than that.
Yeah, we do more than that. In fact, you know, we do the the race line data transfer. We also carry the video across the globe, right? So we do all that. But what's even more important is, all these sensory data are actually traveling on our backbone. In fact, in the earliest part of, when we set up Formula One, I was briefly involved in that, more on the solution side of it, right? So I vividly remember, what all the conversation that was happening between our team and the Formula One, the folks. Mm. Oh, it's a phenomenal, it's an interesting, association that we have.
Absolutely.
I'm not sure how much money we make out of it, but then definitely, a lot of things that we learn. And therefore, that's the reason why I kind of touch upon the innovation contest, right, of Formula One. I'm sure, some of you folks, while we are not eligible officially to participate in it, but some of you folks can actually scratch the surface and see what is there for you guys to get excited on the technology side. Right, because it's a no holds barred contest. There's absolutely no limit to the imagination to the way you really want to make Formula One experience great.
Mm-hmm.
Anand, thank you so much, Jay. And in fact, I was absolutely grooved too when you start talking about Formula One. In fact,
great. So thanks everyone. Thanks for joining in. Do share your comments on WhatsApp group so that indirectly we inspire rest of the guys to participate in the next one. Thanks once again. Thanks, Jay. Thanks, you are a rock star. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a nice weekend.
Bye, guys.
Have a nice weekend. Bye-bye.